session. It's my pleasure to introduce John Duncan. He's going to talk to us about umbral moonshine modules.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm really pleased to have this opportunity to speak. So I'm going to talk about umbral moonshine. So umbral moonshine is a largely still mysterious mechanism which associates automorphic forms of a certain kind, and more specifically, so-called Mach modular forms. I should say distinguished Mach modular forms, and then that the precise sense in which they're distinguished is going to make up a significant part of the talk. And on the other side, we have objects, mathematical objects of a very different flavor, namely automorphism groups. Automorphism groups of some distinguished lattices. Absolutely. Mach modular forms sort of make up the number theoretic content. And here, automorphism groups of some distinguished lattices. Okay, so more specifically, or to explain this mechanism, this association in a little bit more detail, recall that check right now that there are exactly 23 simply laced root systems. Simply laced, I just mean that every root has the same length. So in other words, 23 unions of ADE root systems such that 23 simply laced root systems X such that the total rank is 24. And every irreducible component has the same Coxeter number. So Coxeter number is constant on irreducible components. And that's an easy fact to check. So we can list a few. So take the A1 root system 24 times, that's a solution to this problem. Take A2 12 times, take A3 8 times, and of course you can do that whenever you have a divisor of 24. And slightly more interesting combination is A11, D7, E6. And here, when I write juxtaposition, I mean disjoint union. Disjoint union, or orthogonal. Disjoint union of root systems, or orthogonal, or direct sum. And another interesting example is D4 to the 6. And then E8 cubed is kind of distinguished in a sense, which I'll explain right now. So the significance of these 23 root systems is the following result due to Niemeyer. Niemeyer has shown that for each such root system, there is a unique up to isomorphism, even self-dual positive definite lattice that has that root system as its set of roots. So for each such X, there exists a unique up to isomorphism self-dual positive definite. A lattice of rank 24. And let's give it a name. Let's call it big N X, such that the X is exactly the set of roots in N X. Roots are the vectors with square length 2. Okay, and moreover, any self-dual even positive definite lattice of rank 24 arises as, that has roots arises as one example, as one of these examples. And any self-dual, let's see, even this U positive definite lattice that has roots is isomorphic to such an NX. So we call these lattices, or for the purpose of this talk at least, call these lattices the Niemeyer lattices and call the corresponding root systems the Niemeyer root systems. So we'll call these the Niemeyer root systems. Okay, so these are the 23. These are the distinguished lattices, and to each one associate a group in the following way. So we're interested in the outer automorphisms of these lattices, the automorphisms that don't just come from we'll take Lie theory and sort of root system theory as red. What are the automorphisms you didn't expect just from everything you know about root systems? So these are the groups we'll call GX. Define GX to be the quotient of the automorphism group of NX by the subgroup of automorphisms generated by reflections and root vectors. Subgroup generated by reflections and roots. And it's straightforward to check that's a normal subgroup. Okay, so in joint work with Miranda Chang and Jeff Harvey, we associated a vector-valued Mach modular form of weight 1/2 to every element in each one of these groups GX for each root system X. Associated a Mach modular form HX sub G, so vector valued, I'll use R to index the components, and R runs modulo 2M, where M is the Coxeter number of any irreducible component of X. So I'll just write Coxeter number of X, because it doesn't matter which component you look at. So what's so special about these Mach modular forms? Well, one thing that's special is they should satisfy the following condition. So we predicted the existence of GX modules kx, so by graded gx modules kx, so graded by 2m, and then graded again by r modulo 2m, and then graded by, okay, so I'm going to write integers d, d squared, sorry, d congruent to r squared modulo 4m. D is going to be almost always negative, bounded above by 1. And the corresponding component is graded by negative d over 4m. And here, m is the Coxeter number. Okay, so maybe it looks a bit funny that I make most of the values of d negative, but it turns out that these d's are discriminants of quadratic forms, and they're mostly negative. So that's where they come from. So right, and so these modules are supposed to tie the groups and the Markov module forms together. And the prescription is as follows. We should get back the rth component of HXG by taking a trace of the action of that group, taking greater trace of the action of that group. D equals r squared modulo 4m. D is less than or equal to 1. Take, okay, so I'm going to write a supertrace, which means a difference of ordinary traces, but, well, really, what I really mean here is just, is an ordinary trace picking up a sign, plus or minus 1, according to some very simple rules. That basically I won't. So the main thing to note is that this is a plus sign whenever r is between 0 and m, and when d is less than or equal to 0. Okay, so I haven't told you, haven't explained yet exactly what's special about the HXGs. So, so maybe take that on trust for a moment. So trusting that these HXGs are special functions, then the first big problem in this business is to verify the existence of these GX modules KX. But maybe before I get into that, it's important to give a little bit of an idea of what a Markov modular form is. So we can explain the notion as follows. In preparation for it, I'll just review the notion of Eichel integral. So suppose G is a cusp form of weight 2 minus k for some group gamma. Let's take gamma to be basically commensurable with the modular group, for example. Commensurable with the modular group and k, a half an integer, is going to be general enough. In this situation, define the Eichler integral of g to be this function. So for a given value of tau, integrate from minus tau bar to I to the infinite cusp, tau plus tau prime to the minus k g minus tau prime bar, put a bar over that, integrate with respect to tau prime. Okay, so then armed with that definition, a Mach modular form of weight k for gamma is a holomorphic function on the upper half plane, F say, for which there exists a cusp form, G in the dual weight, such that the completion of F, defined to be F plus Eichler integral of G, is actually a modular form of weight K. So it's just not a modular form in the usual sense, because adding the Eichler integral breaks. When you add the Eichler integral, it stops being holomorphic. So this is a non-holomorphic, but otherwise satisfying all the other conditions that a modular form usually satisfies. Modular form of weight K. Okay, so maybe this looks a bit strange. It's instructive to consider the special case that k equals zero. So for example, take k to be zero. So then a Mach modular form weight zero is a holomorphic function F on the upper half plane for which there exists a cusp form of weight two, such that, well, let's see. If we if this thing, F plus G star, is going to be invariant for the action of gamma, that means F evaluated at gamma times tau plus G star evaluated at gamma times tau is F tau plus G star tau, or in other words, the difference between the failure of F to be just invariant in the usual sense is, it's the difference of these two things, which modulo typos should be something like this. But notice this function doesn't depend on tau, because this is a gamma invariant function which is bounded at cusps, so it must be constant. So actually, we have the condition F gamma tau equals F tau plus some function, call it omega, that just depends on gamma. So for some omega from gamma to c, and this of course is a classical notion. This is a notion of abelian integral from early 19th century. So this notion of Mach modular form is really a very natural generalization of this very familiar notion. So in the case that we're interested in, the weight is for us. These are Mach modular forms of weight 1/2, and then the correction term, correction term used to get the completion right here, call this the completion of F, and call G the shadow of F. So then the correction term is, it's a non-constant function of tau. It is what it is. So maybe one more comment about the weight zero case before we move on to say something about modules. So observe that if we use bold M for Mach modular forms. Oh, and by the way, I should say there are almost so I'm glossing over the issue of growth conditions on these functions at cusps. And it turns out there are almost no examples of Mach modular forms that are that don't have poles. If you don't allow poles at cusps, then there are almost no examples. So Mach modular form always means weakly holomorphic. So, by which I mean you allow some exponential growth at cusps. Weakly holomorphic Mach modular forms of weight k for gamma. Okay, so if we denote the space like so, then we have an exact sequence. Ordinary weakly holomorphic modular forms sit inside the Mach modular forms. They're just the Mach modular forms with vanishing shadow. And the shadow map is a map to S 2 minus K gamma. So we have an exact sequence like so, and you can ask, in the case of, for k equals 0, we can ask the following question. When does this when is there no difference between the space of Mach modular forms, this newfangled space of Mach modular forms and the modular forms that we're used to, and it's clear these spaces coincide exactly when there are no cusp forms of weight 2. So for k equals 0, we have Mach modular equals modular if and only if S2 gamma is 0. Or in other words, if and only if the modular curve defined by gamma is genus 0. So in the remainder of the talk, So two goals. So the first is to describe the So recently the existence of these GX modules KX has been verified. And describe the proof of that. And then give an argument that these Mach modular forms that appear here are distinguished. And actually, so what we'll see is that they are controlled exactly by a genus zero condition like this. Okay, so umbral Mach modular forms. All right. So in joint work with Michael Griffin and Ken Ono, we verified the existence of these GX modules KX. And in so doing, kind of verified that the Mach modular forms sort of verified that the Mach modular forms HXG that we came up with Miranda and Jeff were sort of the right thing. Of the KX. So actually the result that we proved with Michael and Ken is very simple. So to describe it, for make the following definition. So for chi a character of GX, define a vector-valued function depending on chi by setting HX chi R to be 1 over order of GX, sum over G's in GX, evaluate chi at G, take the, what is that, complex conjugate, and multiply by the value, multiply by this function. All right, so then according to orthogonality of characters of a, ordinary characters of finite group, we must recover the original functions, hxg, by, in the following way, take the sum of characters, sum of irreducible characters of gx, chi of g, x chi r. And what that tells us is that the coefficients of the chi of the hx chi's are just the multiplicities of chi in the module kx, supposing it exists. And going the other way, to verify the existence of kx, just to verify the existence of kx as a gx module, just means showing that these multiplicities are non-negative integers. So the coefficients of the hx chi r are the multiplicities of gx, irreducible gx modules in the putative gx module kx. We just have to check that these multiplicities are non-negative integers. And okay, so that's very easy to do in principle. The only problem is that there's infinitely many. So how to turn this infinite problem into a finite one? And well, what we'd like to do is apply Sturm's theorem, which gives a bound on the number of coefficients you need to know before you know a modular form, given that it lives in some particular space. So the problem, of course, is that these functions right here are not modular forms. They don't live in any space of modular forms. They're mock modular forms. Well, what I'd like to describe to you is a way of kind of pushing them back into the world of modular forms which is not using the original definition, which is to say, without moving into the world of non-holomorphic objects. And that method is so-called holomorphic projection. So we can push the HX chi's back into spaces of into modularity by applying so-called holomorphic projection. So I'll explain the sort of the basic case corresponding to which in the context of umbral moonshine corresponds to when the underlying root system is a union of ans. The point is it's another way of taming these mock modular objects, and well, it therefore gives us a different kind of perspective on what kind of objects they are. So here is the result, or in advance of a statement of the result, let's just introduce a little bit of notation. So define theta sub mr sup 1 to be a theta null, specifically this one. Sum over integers k that are congruent to r mod 2m, k q to the k squared over 4m. So you might recognize this as the theta null of theta series naturally attached to some Faye representation. What next? So I'm gonna rewrite this. So we can rewrite this as a summing over non-negative n's this equality isn't true yet. I have to put some signs in here. Let phi sub mr be the function which tells you what the signs are. So given those phi mr's, define a function dmr as follows. Take the sum of d's. Let's see, d's less than or equal to 0, sum over a's and b's greater than or equal to 0, such that a squared minus b squared equals minus d. And then put down this. sine depending on A, sine depending on B. Oh, and of course, this is zero for most n's. Right, this sum is over k's that are equal to r modulo 2m. So this phi mr is zero whenever n is not congruent to plus or minus r modulo 2m. So most of these terms are zero. Okay, define this function like so. One thing you'll notice is that it looks like this is a function with fractional powers of q, but actually they all turn out to be integral because most of these terms are zero. So if you have a non-zero coefficient here, then d is divisible by 4m. Okay, so with those with that notation, I'll explain a special case of holomorphic projection. So the theorem we use, which is essentially due to Zagier, as I understand it, and then sort of made more maybe more explicit, maybe a bit more general by Michael Mertens, is the following. If is a Mach modular form. I should say I'm gonna give a very specific case of Michael Mertens' very general result. So the specific case I'm gonna describe is the following. If F is a Mach modular form of weight 1/2 for gamma, principal congruent subgroup, level 4m. And if the shadow of F is a constant times one of these theta nulls, so that sounds pretty restrictive. But as far as Umbral Moonshine goes, it's essentially as general as you need. And sort of I'll explain why a little bit later. We'll see soon. Soon we will see sort of why that's true. Shadow C times some constant times theta 1 MR. Then the following function, F, define a new function, big F, taking little f times the theta null, times its shadow, really, plus C times DMR. So what are we doing here? We're taking the Mach modular form and multiplying by its shadow, and then adjusting by this thing, which I would like you to think of it as canonically constructed from the theta function. If I gave you a different theta function, then you know, with minimal effort, you would come up with the analog, the analogous DMR. So the statement then is that big F is very nearly modular. It's modular plus something times E2. It's quasi-modular on gamma 4n. This function belongs to a quasi-modular weight 2. Belongs to a space of weight 2 modular forms, gamma 4m, extended by the quasi-modular Eisenstein series E2. So obviously that is a space to which Sturm's theorem can be applied. So maybe let me show you an example. If x equals a1 to the 24, that was kind of the simplest example of an Niemeyer root system, then the corresponding group is actually quite a fascinating group. So this is the sporadic group M24, or the largest sporadic group, largest sporadic simple group of Mathieu. And so the it turns out that the HXGs, a Coxeter number is 2 now. So our HXGs, their components are running modulo 4, but they satisfy the symmetry HXGR equals minus HXG minus R. So you can see that when R equals 0, I get 0, and when R equals 2, I get 0. And the component for r equals 1 is the negative the component for r equals 3. So I only really need to know what r equals, or the function with r equals 1 is. There's only really one component here, even though it looks like there's 4. Well, we take f to be that component, h, and I'll take g to be the identity. Then this function happens to have the following Fourier expansion. Minus 2 is q to the minus 1 over 8 plus 90 times q to the 7 over 8 plus 462 times q to the 15 over 8. And if you are super familiar with M24, or if you have the Atlas of Finite Groups in front of you by chance, then you can look at the character table and recognize dimensions of reducible representations of M24. And in this case, we have theta, the shadow is 24 times theta 1, 2, comma 1. Theta 1, 2, comma 1 turns out to just be the eta function cubed. And what is the modular form F we're landing on in this case? Well, it turns out that because of the symmetry under the components, it looks like we're living on gamma 8. We're actually living on the full modular group. So in this case, F is just a multiple of E2. I think that multiple is minus 2. So this is a super nice case. And you can see from this equation that this very sort of non-trivial object right here. If we plug it in for f, then we have an equation which relates it to extremely manageable things: the cube of the eta function, the quasi-modular Eisenstein series E2, this thing which is also essentially the cube of the eta function. So we get recursions for the coefficients. In particular, we get recursion relations for the coefficients of this Mach modular form attached to M24 in terms of these very classical objects. So it's a fascinating prospect for the field to really figure out the deeper meaning of those recursion. Okay, so in the last 10 minutes, I'd like to try and demonstrate that these Mach modular forms attached to umbral moonshine are also controlled by genus zero groups. So, umbral moonshine. So now the umbral Mach modular forms. So this is joint work with Miranda Cheng, and the punchline is that these special Mach modular forms are also controlled Y. Genus zero groups. Groups that don't have any weight two cusp forms. So the first step in explaining what that means is to replace these vector-valued objects with scalar-valued ones. And there's a very natural way to do that. So, and that is the following. So, define, well, we can do that at the expense of introducing another variable. So define phi x tau z to be sum over the components r, which are running modulo 2m, hx, I'm just going to focus on the case that g is the identity element. I've got the rth component. I multiply by this theta function, whose sort of theta null we already met, the theta mr, you can probably guess, is sum over k's that are congruent to r modulo 2m q to the k squared over 4m y to the k. Now, the significance of this object is that it is so-called Mach Jacobi form of weight 1. So notice that by making this move from vector-valued Mach modular forms to Mach Jacobi forms, we also made life a little bit easier. At half integral weight, we're not really talking about modular forms for SL2Z, we're talking about modular forms for the metaplate to cover. When we're back in integral weight land, then we don't have to worry about that. That extra projective factor goes away. So that's one slight technical advantage of making this move. So another advantage is that it makes more clear the connection to cusp forms of weight 2. So I feel like I should explain a little bit what a Mach Jacobi form of weight 1 is. What a Mach Jacobi form is. So the definition. Yeah, okay, so say phi holomorphic function on H cross C is a Mach Jacobi form of weight k and index m if there exists, well, if one, so phi is phi should be elliptic of index m. What does that mean? So given integers a and b, define the index m action of a comma b to be following. Basically, translate in the z variable, moving along the lattice defined by tau. So that should be, so we pick up some. I think I managed to not say yet what I mean by Q and Y. So that should be equal to the original function phi. And here, Q is e to the 2 pi I tau, and Y is e to the 2 pi I z. So this is the first condition. Second condition, there should exist a skew holomorphic Jacobi form, a cuspidal skew holomorphic Jacobi form sigma, I'm going to write SQ in the dual weight, 3 minus k, such that phi hat, which is phi plus the completion of sigma, is invariant for the weight equals k index m action of SL2Z. So the notion of skew holomorphic Jacobian form might not be super familiar. And if I give you the, so time is kind of short, so probably it's better that I spare everybody the definition. Of course, I'm happy to give it if you ask, or after the talk. The main point, let me tell you the main point about them, so better to at least motivate the definition. And this will and this motivation also demonstrates the last remaining point of the talk, which is the following. So Skorupa's Argie together defined an injective map from Jacobi forms of weight k and index m to modular forms of weight 2k minus 2 and level m. And well, this correspondence has some overlap with the Shimura lift. It's kind of a Jacobi form version of the Shimura lift. But what was kind of curious was that you only see about half of the modular forms of level m in this way. You only see modular forms that are invariant for the action of the Akinlena. The Fricker involution. So there should be something on the left-hand side that also that allows you to see modular forms that are anti-invariant for the Fricker involution. Well, the notion of skew holomorphic Jacobi form solves that problem. So Skorupa subsequently introduced the notion of skew holomorphic Jacobi form and demonstrated that together the direct sum of these spaces injects into the space of modular forms, and this correspondence is equivariant and Akinlena equivariant. In particular, there are natural Akinlena involutions acting here, so it's an extremely beautiful result. But the significance for us is that if we are looking at Mach modular forms, Mach Jacobi forms with weight equals 1, then the shadows have weight 3 minus 1 equals 2. And then this correspondence here takes skew holomorphic Jacobi forms of weight 2 and gives you modular forms of weight 2. Then Skorupa's map attaches a modular form attaches an element of M2 level little m to to the Mach degree form phi. So directly analogously to the modular form case, we have an exact sequence. Zero maps to space of let me specialize k to be one. So Jacobi forms with some growth condition map into Mach Jacobi forms of weight one and index m. Some growth condition maps to cuspidal skew holomorphic Jacobi forms in the dual weight. And we can ask, as we did before, when is J weak 1 comma m equal to, when are there no Mach Jacobi forms? Well, turns out that's not a good question to ask, because this space on the left is always zero. And actually, this space on the right is never zero, unless m equals one. So at least for m equals one, if m greater than one, it's always non-zero. So then we can ask, when is it as small as possible? And the answer is, it's as small as possible when this space vanishes. And that happens exactly when gamma naught m has genus zero. So this thing right here is as small as possible when gamma naught m is a genus zero group. And well, this property manifests the number of moonshine. The gamma naught m's that are genus zero, they correspond exactly to the examples, to the root systems that have an A-type component. So in Niemeyer's original classification, there was a genus zero property sitting there. The root systems with an A-type component, corresponds to Hecker congruence groups that are genus zero. Okay, so I better stop there. Thanks.